Welcome to the Tournament Poker Edge podcast, brought to you by TournamentPokerEdge.com, the only podcast dedicated exclusively to tournament poker strategy. And now, here are your hosts, Ron Fezbuddy and Killing Bird.
Hey everybody, welcome to the Tournament Poker Edge podcast. I'm Killing Bird, here as always with Ron Fezbuddy, a.k.a. Diego. How are you, sir?
Pretty good, getting back to normal life.
Yes, finally.
Yeah. I'm not quite over yet, the main event still.
Yeah, that's always hard, right? The recovering from the bust out. I mean, I've never played the main, right? But everybody I know who has said it's the worst feeling in the world, busting the main event.
It's the worst feeling. Like, you know, I thought about it. I mean, I still think about it once or twice a day. But first week, like, and I felt okay. I mean, I think we covered this. Did we cover this on the podcast?
We talked about it a little bit in the...
Yeah. We covered it on the TP Live. I felt okay with my play. I didn't really hate the way I played. I thought I played okay. I just did, you know, got no hands, and I ran into a hand I probably should have folded, lost a decent amount of chips, but we didn't think it was awful. A lot of people didn't think it was awful. So I felt like it was out of my control, but it still just feels like, could I have done this differently? What if this card would have hit?
And it only comes around once a year, yeah. Right? So you got to wait a long time to play it again.
Yeah, and just as you're feeling a little bit better, then they start getting down to the final table, and you know, following that news, you know.
And when you get over it this time, then the coverage will start on ESPN.
Yeah. It's awful. It really sucks, man.
Yeah, it probably took me like a good week and a half or 2 weeks to kind of get back to wanting to play poker again, and I didn't even play and bust the main. I didn't play the main, so and I still needed a good 2 weeks to just kind of get my head straight and get back to grinding, which I think I've finally done. But it takes a while.
I'm
for sure.
I'm super reinvigorated. Like after, I'm still sad about the main, but poker wise, I'm feeling amazing right now. I'm loving poker lately. I put $100 on the new lock because I didn't really have anything on lock before. I put $100 and I'm playing, I don't know, man. I think we talked about this before. I'm just playing 2-3 tables at a time and really, what I did to start, like I tried to get my, you know, since we don't have stars or FTP, obviously, playing merge here and there, but not really grinding. I really wanted to get, you know, I've been watching a lot of TP videos, World Series, and the Danny's videos, who's going to be on in a little while, really have changed my late game and my sort of 3-bet 4-bet game,
right?
Way better. And Daryl Jace's videos, his hand history reviews are his best videos by far, and the way he analyzes a hand is. It's amazing. It's just, you know, just watching those. And I think that I was, you know, absorbing that and doing well at the main, you know, but I feel like in the month since I've been back or whatever, it's been 20 days and the sessions I put in at lock, and just focusing on hand reading, like light years. I don't know. You always feel like you're better than you were before, but I feel like light years better than I was before I started this sort of recent regimen of training, watching video a night, playing less tables, even less tables, and just like focusing. And the real benefit and key has been a series that he handed in that we have not yet released. It's in the vault, CPE, and I'm not sure I'm going to release it. No, we just have a bunch of. We'll talk about it later when we talk about what's new at TPE. We just have a bunch of people ahead of him because he's been pretty recently putting videos out. We have some returning people who were at the World Series and didn't put out as many videos ahead of him. So it's scheduled that it's coming, and we'll talk about it later. But he put out a series that it's about how to analyze hand histories, and he spends an hour on each hand, basically.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
He spends an hour. And you would think, like, how the hell do you spend an hour? And then – when you see what he does for these expert-level hand history reviews, you can see why he spent an hour, because he's thinking, he actually starts off the video with like his 4 or 5 step process for thinking through hands when you're reviewing them. And, uh-huh. you know, he's thinking of everything, you know, ranges, you know, based on what they did pre on the position, how the range is affected by what came on the flop, how to play against those ranges depending on the different type of player, how to play, what cards are good for you, what cards are bad for you, how to play, you know, future streets at that point, right? So that he knows what to do on the flop based on how certain cards affect his post, you know, his turn and river play. So like
right.
super intricate thought process, and it's a lot to absorb. I've actually been watching him in like 10-minute chunks and then just absorbing. So we'll talk about it a little bit more later. But anyway, I don't know. Got me on a rambling, you know, a rant about just studying more and paying more attention. And it's been really great. I've been doing really well. I ran it up like from that $100 to almost 1,000 unlocked just in the past week since I got back and started playing again.
Yeah, I think it's good. Like you found something to reinvigorate your game,
yeah.
and I think I had mentioned to you, and if not, I mentioned to a couple of the other TPE guys that, like, I'm trying to find a way to sort of reinvigorate my game, not even my game, but my urge to play the game.
Right.
And I still enjoy playing, but I don't feel like I'm playing optimally all the time because I'm playing strictly for the enjoyment of it. If that
right.
makes any sense.
Yeah.
Like, it's more just about, like, being online and hanging out in TP chat.
Yeah, yeah,
and talking
yeah. yeah. yeah.
And I don't feel like I'm putting my best foot forward, so I think I had mentioned to you that I was going to maybe put, like, some sort of bankroll challenge
right.
for myself, you know, like, try to run 500 up to 5K
honestly,
in a certain time.
You should just try to play the best poker you could possibly play. Make that the challenge. And, like, start making less mistakes. And, like, attain to play hands as well as possible, and when you look back at hand history reviews, to make as least mistakes as possible.
Right.
That is a really, like, it's a self-motivation. You have to have discipline, but that's been my discipline, to, like, just become better. And you know what really has been sort of the carrot at the end of the stick is that I don't, you know, we don't get to play live a lot, but I don't get to play live a lot. I know in North Carolina you don't. But having a live tournament that's a pretty decent-sized buy-in and could be decent money, like, I'm forcing myself to be training for that event, you know?
Yeah,
like, so
yeah, that's a good point. That's a good way to look at it.
That's what I'm doing. So, like, online to me is, like, I'm not trying to make the most money possible online right now because, you know, if I were, I'd be playing 8 tables on, you know, Merge and Lock or 12 tables or whatever.
Right.
But what I'm trying to do is just be – and I know this is not applicable to the people who are making a living off of poker, you know, this strategy.
Sure.
But
yeah, you and I happen to be in the same sort of boat as far as poker goes.
Right,
like,
right.
Yeah,
it's a
we're not
love, but
relying solely on that as money. So.
Right, but I'm trying to be the best possible player at that one table at all times, make the best possible plays at that one table at all times, because I'm training myself for live events, basically.
Yeah.
Which, you know, it's more important to make the, you know, the perfect decision, or, you know, the right decision at that moment than it is to, you know, be able to make the right decision that goes over 20 tables.
Right. Yeah, that's a good idea. Maybe I'll try to sort of shift my mindset to that, because I think we're both heading up to Atlantic City for the Borgata event.
Yeah.
At least, you know, a couple of events there.
Right. That was what I was going to get at. So having the World Series as the target, you know, forced me to start learning more and train better. And now September 5th, the Borgata's having, well, I think the 5th through the 13th, they're having their, what is it, fall series or something? I don't even know what they...
Yeah, Borgata Poker Open,
maybe? Right,
I think
like that. But they're having a $500 1 million guarantee on the 5th, I think, and the 5th and 6th is two
yep.
starting days. So, or the 4th and 5th, I don't really remember. But, so I'm just, you know, I know it's one tournament, and, you know, it's in the long run, it's, you know, anything could happen, and that's evidenced by, you know, how bad the main went with, you know, card deadness and all that stuff. But I just feel like training myself for that event is forcing me to learn better.
Right.
So, anyway.
Yeah.
Enough of my high horse.
I think it's a good way to look at it. And I have a few other events coming up, because I always go to Atlantic City in December with some buddies for my home game.
Yeah.
So I'll have that to kind of prepare for. And then we're actually getting – North Carolina is getting their first – real poker tournament.
Yeah.
WSOP circuit event's coming to North Carolina. Oh, not this year. Next year, actually.
In April of 2013, right?
Yeah. That's pretty exciting.
Yeah, that must be exciting.
Yeah, I mean, AC is about as close as it gets for poker for us. And NAC is like 7.5-8 hours away.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
To have something, I mean, it's Western North Carolina. So it's still like 3.5-4 hours away. It's still a decent haul. But to me, that's like, that. It feels like it's 45 minutes away.
Well, that's what, for me, that's what AC is. It takes me about 3.5 hours to get there.
Yeah.
So it still feels like, well, yeah, it's doable. You can even drive it home in one night if you have to.
Right.
You know, I mean, you have to drive it home one night, but you could do it like at the end of a night if you have to. You know,
yeah.
Like if I bust an AC tournament at like 10 or 11, I go home, right? You know,
yeah.
Like I don't stick around. If it's past 12, I usually stick around, but before that. So that.
Plus, it's just cool for North Carolina in general,
For
North Carolina, but for the North Carolina poker scene, if you will.
Well, what's great is that you're going to have a bunch of players who don't really play live playing live for the first time.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to that. What I'm not looking forward to is having a casino that hasn't spread live poker up until recently, but hopefully by then they'll have a lot of the bugs worked out.
Yeah,
so.
I mean, it's still, the trade-off is definitely worth it.
Oh, yeah, I'll take it. I'll take a couple bad dealers for 9 bad players all day.
Right. Yeah, right, exactly.
Yeah, so it's going to be fun, though. I'm definitely looking forward to that.
Yeah, I'm telling you, it's you guys got to watch Danny's last series. It really, I love that guy's videos. It's just, his attunity to stack sizes and what he can do in terms of 3 and 4 betting and what he can't do, really just opened my eyes. Like it really changed. I don't know. I guess for the best grinders out there is probably it's just knowledge at this point that they have. But he's really amazing at that, especially just. You know, on bubbles and whatnot, and how, you know, these guys can't call because, you know, other stacks are short too, and, you know, at the final table, you know, exploitation. And I've really put that to work in the last couple of sessions, and it just works.
Yeah. Yeah. He's a super smart guy. I learned that having spent a lot of time talking hands with him over the summer. I mean, he takes some really creative lines, but he's also really good at just breaking down situations and.
Yeah.
And thinking them through from all those different aspects you mentioned. So,
cool. Well, why don't we get him on?
So, yeah, I think that's a good idea. So we're going to have Danny and Cougars on. I know Cougars just finished up a live event, so we'll talk to him a little bit about that. We'll talk some hands with those guys. But first we'll take a quick little break, and then we'll come back on the TPE podcast.
Hey MTTers, this is Casey Big Dog Pocket Fives Jarzebeck from TournamentPokerEdge.com. If you've been looking for a trading site dedicated exclusively to tournament poker, then look no further. Tournament Poker Edge is only $23.95 per month with no initial sign-up fee, and we post a new training video every weekday. You'll also find poker-related articles, blogs, and very active strategy forums. We even offer you the ability to upload your own video for others to discuss. So head on over to TournamentPokerEdge.com and find out why it's quickly becoming the destination for tournament poker players looking to take their game to the next level. TournamentPokerEdge.com.
Hey, everybody. Welcome back to the Tournament Poker Edge podcast. Time to bring in Cougars4444 and DannyN13. Hello, gentlemen.
Here comes Cougars Gay.
Hi.
Hey.
Hey.
I knew it was coming.
Hey. What's up, Heat Wave?
Heat Wave.
Oh, I knew I'd never hear the end of that.
For those who don't know what we're talking about, Cougars was deep in a live tournament, our live pro on the line, and he tweeted a picture of the trophy that was up for grabs.
Literally, I think somebody should have just ran out with it. It was so disgusting.
And it was this shoddy little trophy, but at the top it wrote Heat Wave was written at the top of the trophy.
That was the name of the tournament. It was the Daytona Beach Heat Wave because it's hot out.
Flames on the trophy, though.
It did.
Yeah. Describe it. Describe it. You had a better look. I only saw the tweet. What was it like in person?
I don't even know where to begin. Yeah. It looked like they got it from a thrift store. But for some reason, I wanted that more than the money.
First, get the ring, then you get the bracelet.
Yeah. You get isn't your new black chip username Heatwave4444?
Maybe.
Tell the truth, you were really at a hot sauce contest. You weren't really.
The trophy would have been more fitting if I was at a hot sauce contest, that is for sure.
Oh, too good. So we know Cougar's been up to playing a little bit of live poker. Danny, you've been back from Vegas for what, about 2 weeks or so?
Yep. Back online, back on PokerStars and FeldStars. Killing it, but just missing. So annoying. Same as always.
Life story.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, life of an MTT grinder, right?
Yep.
And are you adjusting back to normal life after spending the summer?
Yeah, I'm pretty good. I actually locked in a year of gym membership. Thank God I'm fat as fuck, so.
That's true.
You guys ate 4 meals a day. Do you realize that? You guys would eat at 6 and then again at 10.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's why.
Why wouldn't you? It was free. Well, it really wasn't free. You lost $47,000 to PTs.
What, you the made car their game didn't help us out?
Yeah, they're thinking they're going to figure out 2012 yearly projections, and it's going to be based off whether the Canadians come back and stay at the house across the street for the summer.
I get weekly mailings from them now.
What do you guys like?
Do you really?
Gold, diamond members there?
Pretty much. I got a thing actually exactly today inviting me to host my fantasy football draft at PT's Pub.
And you get for your team?
I heard next year when we're going back, they're going to roll out the red carpet and everything.
I believe it.
Yeah.
He's got high roller jet service to PT's Pub.
We'll wherever the house is, it will be close to PT's Pub. Right. That's all I can confirm.
Within walking distance.
Yeah. So,
where were we?
Also, recently, both of you guys signed on with Poker Sites, correct?
Yeah.
I was first, so obviously.
So if you're looking to find a new poker site, especially a U.S.-facing one, make sure you follow at DannyN13 and at Cougars4444. They'll be tweeting out their respective links so you can get signed up and do your thing.
Yeah.
Cool. Well, let's do what we are all here to do, which is talk a little bit of Strat. I think we're going to start with Cougars, right?
Oh, great. This is going to be awesome.
There we go. On the rippling part.
So, yeah, we get to talk some hands from the Heatwave Classic.
Sticking it to Cougs. So, two fun hands. Well, they weren't really fun for me, but I guess they were fun discussion points. So the structure was the slowest $500 structure, I think, in the history of the world. I think the only longer tournament I've played was the World Series Poker Main Event, and that's a $10,000 buy-in. But you start with 40,000 in chips. The blinds start at 25.50, has almost every single level, and it's 40-minute levels.
Wow.
But it was awesome the way it was set up because they made it so working people could play because they had day ones Monday through Friday that all started at 6 p.m. and were all done by 1 a.m., and everybody joined together on Saturday.
Really?
To play day
fantastic.
Two.
That's awesome.
I wish they would do that everywhere. That's fantastic.
That's huge, yeah.
My wife would hate me. I would always be out playing poker. I swear to God.
Wow. And then if you busted like I played on Tuesday, you could re-enter the first three levels of the same day, and you could re-enter any of the next days. If like you bust on Tuesday, you can play Wednesday. Bust Wednesday, you can play Thursday until you make a day two.
So what is
that? How many fish were in there?
It played about the equivalent of a $2 freeze out on stars.
Unbelievable.
Wow. So they played 7 hours on each of the day ones. Right?
7 hours on each of the day ones, nine so 40-minute levels.
What is like a normal tournament, like WSOPC or something play? They play from 12 to
2.
They play pretty late, right? So mm-hmm. So you're not getting nearly as much, as deep after day one as you
no.
were.
No. And then they made a mistake, which I think they'll fix in the down the road. They started day two at 10 a.m. and we were done by 5:30 for whatever reason.
Yeah,
that's
like
9 months on day two. Yeah. So I had to drive over. It's like 40 minutes from us. I had to drive over for day three, and there's 61 players left, and they only paid 33. I'm like, this is going to really suck if I drove over here 3 days and didn't even cash in a $500
tournament. Well, you know what? Then that makes sense. What they basically did was they took a day one from a WSOPC and broke it into 2 days.
Well, and also I think, and it's been the casino's best interest, what they did was you play day two from 10 to 5:30. A lot of people stay and play cash after that. whether they bust.
Ooh, yeah, that's a great
idea. They make day three. They stay and they just play cash for a few more hours. They're already there.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then they just come back
sounds
on.
Genius.
I was just going to say, sounds like the future. sounds fantastic. I love it. No, I think that's what it is, because if you think about it, those WSCPCs are 2 days, right? So it's one really long day one, and you come back with like 30 people, and then you finish up on day two. So you basically came back to 30 people on day three. They just split day one into two different
days.
Yeah, it's cool.
Yep. You'd be a lot more fresh, man. I would love to do that.
Yeah. Even day three. Well, you'd love to do it, except when you're driving 40 minutes each way. If you're like right there, it's perfect.
Yeah.
But then day three, I think they ended. I obviously didn't win because I don't have the awesome hot sauce trophy. But day three ended at like 8:30 at night. So I mean, day three is a little longer, but still not bad. 10 to 8:30.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah.
Okay. So anyway, so this hand is. Start with 40,000 chips. We're on day two. Blinds are 2K, 4K. I have 160K to start the hand. Under the gun is a young, aggressive player who just got moved to the table with he's probably one of the chip leaders of the tournament. He's probably got like 600K at this point.
Are you just profiling him as aggressive because he's young, or did you actually see him do anything?
He had
I got a serious question. I'm not trying to be.
He played aggressive the five hands I'd seen him. He was probably in four of the five pots. So
okay,
I'm
that's what I was trying to ask. Okay,
quoting him as aggressive. I guess I don't know for sure. Maybe he got hands all four times. So he opens to 10K at 2K, 4K. The person on his left is a middle-aged, gambly Asian with about 130K. He flats.
That's a great screen name, Gambly Asian.
I like it.
I'm using it.
Pulls awesome. To another younger. At first, I thought he was a wizard, but on second thought, he had no clue what he was doing. Gentleman on the button. For some reason, they also have 10K chips there. So we, to start of the tournament, we had 2,500, 500, 1K, 5K. We had and 10K chips. Six different chips, which is pretty ridiculous. So he goes to call by throwing in two oranges, the 5Ks. And accidentally throws in two grays, so he raises the 20K.
Huh.
So there's, it was clearly obvious. He made a big stink. He obviously didn't mean to do it at all. And I, at that point, I had no reason not to believe him. Like, I didn't think he was trying to shoot an angle or anything. He wasn't nearly smart enough.
Right.
So I'm in the big blind. There's just about 50K in the pot at this point. I have 160K, and I look down at two aces. What do you do?
So it was 10K, a call,
the
20K by mistake.
20K by mistake.
And then you in the bluff.
Yes.
Interesting.
Huh.
Okay, let me think here.
So you have you basically have 40 bigs to start the hand.
Yeah.
Huh.
I would raise it. Make it look angly, but not actually like shove. But I would make it like 40K, but like try to throw a billion chips in there to make it look angly. I don't know. I don't know if it's too fancy, but I'm not going to shove because I feel like even though it looks like I'm making a move here on a guy who made a mistake, people aren't going to risk their tournament life with that. But then I can open someone up to make a mistake or.
But do you think the guy who made the mistake is strong here?
No, I don't. But I think the under the gun is the only one, is the one that might go with it. I'm trying to angle the under the gun, not the guy who made the mistake.
Because if I think the guy who made the mistake is strong there, I like the shove, and then he'll put you on ace king.
But why do you think he's strong if he made a mistake? He was just flatting.
Oh, he was just flatting.
Yeah.
Yeah, he meant to just flat.
Oh, yeah. Wow, that's so weird.
Yeah, you're telling me.
Yeah, that's so weird.
See, I was actually thinking of angling a different. Well, I don't know. Angle makes it sound negative, but I was actually thinking about flatting because then you get aggressive opener to maybe reship because none of us look strong here, right? If the only guy who raised made a mistake.
You also have to realize I'm the only one in this entire tournament wearing a patch, and they all think I'm like some younger superstar hotshot for whatever reason, just because I bought a patch out of the quarter.
So were you aggressive at this point?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, it looks like a great spot to squeeze light, to, or not squeeze, but three bet light.
Yep.
So I would probably make it
four bet light.
Three bet.
No, four
oh,
bet.
Oh, yeah, he misclicked. Yeah, four. Yeah, so yeah, 45K is enough.
Yeah, exactly. Like four, I was like, I'm thinking like 43 with a bunch of chips just to make it look like I'm trying to take this pot down.
Yeah, it makes sense to me, I guess.
Yeah, I wish I had thought it through like that.
And it's really hard in that situation.
In the moment, yeah. I was literally telling myself what looks the steeliest. I don't even know if that's a word, but I just used it. What makes it look the most like I'm just flat out trying to steal? And I didn't want to tank for too long, you know, and give away like I, you know, really had a decision here. But I probably tanked for a good 45 seconds, and then I just shoved.
Yeah, the problem is you have an under-the-gun opener, so it's really hard to think you're going to shove their light as a steal because, you know, the guy is under the gun, and he has a higher probability of having a hand, and, you know, you probably do realize that.
I don't necessarily agree with that for a younger guy.
But put in 40.
For a younger, aggressive guy, I think the chances are he could be an online guy, too, and he's stealing under the gun a ton, so he could be light. So
yeah, I agree. I agree with that, yes. But he still has a higher percentage chance of having a decent hand here than he normally does if he's opening late. I guess I'm just saying throw in.
I think 40, he has the exact same, to be completely honest.
Fair enough. But throw in 40 bigs when you are facing someone who's under the gun, you know, seems like...
Yeah, no, that's why
definitely
I like the three bets instead of the stuff
yeah,
all day.
Right.
Oh, I agree. I probably
give him the chance to spaz.
Yeah. I should have four
bets. It looks like you're the aggro pro or whatever, and you're just taking that spot because you know the guy misclicked obviously is weak because he's meant to flat or whatever, and it's just a great spot for you to pick up a ton of chips.
Yep.
So
yeah.
I think you get a spaz there a ton from an aggro online kid.
Yep. Like he'll jam nines or something over you.
I agree. I should have just done that. In the moment, I was just trying to, in my head, I convinced myself that's what looked the steeliest, the bluffiest, just trying to take it down. And to be honest with you, I mean, I was able to add 50K to my stack without a showdown. I mean, I wanted a showdown, but that's not ever a bad result when you increase your stack by 33% as well.
Yeah.
True.
No, it's definitely not a bad result, of course.
But obviously, I was wanting to call them.
Optimally, to put yourself in a position to win a tournament if a guy spazzes, you know.
Yeah, no, I would have put myself in a much better position, I agree. And I wish I had done that, but at the time, I just, you know, it didn't work out.
Definitely a weird spot. Yeah.
That is weird. So we all agree that my idea was the worst of the three.
And under the gun ended up folding tens, he said.
Yeah, he would have jammed.
It actually got weird after that. So I shove, and the guy on my right, the gentleman that misclicked, gets up and just leaves the table.
What?
Oh, my gosh.
Like
frustrated leaves?
No, like he had to pee, and he was like, I'm not waiting, and he just got up and left. No, and he had made a mistake, and he was folding.
Oh, then you definitely would have got jammed on if you made it 43, because then the guy would have saw he was out of the hand.
Yeah, I realized that after the fact. But I'm sitting there going, I just don't want to give anything away. Maybe I should have made a stink about it, but I was hoping they would, you know, I don't know, I was hoping it was easier for him to call, knowing that the guy couldn't have accidentally misclicked the big hand or whatever.
Right.
But he still ended up folding 10, so obviously I took the worst line because that was bad.
10 was common, whatever.
Yeah, there you go.
He saved chips.
And then, of course, when he folds, I go, phew. He goes, I should have called you, huh? I go, what'd you have? He goes, tens. I go, oh, yeah, you were real good. You believe me? It got me some action later on, so I guess it worked out.
Hey, Derek, I don't like a call because now you're playing kings out of position against three other players. I think that's definitely not the right, definitely the wrong move.
Aces, but yeah, I agree. It was aces, right?
Yeah, was it? It was aces.
Oh, I thought it was kings.
I was trying to figure out what just happened there.
Same. So lost.
I'm like, what is going on? I don't even know what they're talking about at this point. Did I miss something? A whole hand? Or all right. So
the second
yum yum sauce.
Second sticking it to the man of or sticking it to Cougs hand was, so we are down to 22 players. I had run my 188K stack going into day three up to like 860. I was back down to 765.
How did you run it up so high? What happened? Like, you don't have to give us all the hands, obviously, but just how did you? That's a huge.
Well, I had a kid, a younger guy, 3X, an old man flat on the button. I looked down, ace queen shoved. They both folded. I had an old man raise the button with 9 big blinds and fold to my shove from the small blind. I cold 4-bet ace 9 over a raise, a 3-bet, and a flat, and they all folded.
Wow,
so,
you grew a set, huh?
Yeah, every once in a while. Come on, I got to stop doing these podcasts and giving away my image. So, because I'm sure these people in Daytona are listening to this. I don't even know if they
are.
Computers. So, anyway, so I'm down to 765K. The blinds are now 15K, 30K, with a 4K ante. Playing eight-handed. I have, you know, just over 25 bigs. I looked down at king-queen of clubs under the gun, and I raised to 62K. I get flatted in late position by a middle-aged, station-y, but can get aggressive in spots that I've seen guy. He had, trying to make sure I get these stacks right, I want to say he had right around 600K. And then I get flatted by the big blind, who had 580K to start the hand, and he was down to 11K. Probably 15 hands ago, and was one of those live riding the rush type of guys.
Nice.
So the flop comes 4-5-5, 2 diamonds, 1 heart. Under the gun checks. There's about 220K in the middle, I think. Or yeah, about 220K in the middle. No, 240K in the middle. Checks to me. I've been toying with this idea, and I know I outleveled myself here, and I shouldn't have, of delay c-betting a lot. And also, I just think the guy, late to act, will use his power of position. Like, he's competent enough to do that. And I didn't just want to c-bet here and get blown off the hand. Like,
yeah, I totally would do the same thing.
Are you c-betting there normally, or are you just checking it back?
Not really, no.
You're just checking it most of the time?
Yep.
Okay, I was kind of torn on whether I should be betting there, but then also later on I got 2 really good streets of value by delay c-betting. I've been doing it more often because I feel like people have kind of caught on to the c-bet even live.
They have, yeah, I agree.
And they're shutting down a lot more in the turn and then to river aggression, so it seems, especially when I'm trying to pot control there.
Right. So wait, yeah. What was the callers? It was you were under the gun. There was a
I raised under the gun.
A late position.
I flatted the big blind flatted.
You flatted the big blind flatted. And you bet to what was the blinds? 1530.
I made it 62.
And you made it 62. So there's like 100 and there's like 190 or something in the pot at this point.
There's 240 in the pot, I think.
60.
180, 195 plus 4 times 8, 30, 220 in the pot with the annies. 4K
okay.
Annie.
Oh, that's big anties. Actually, yeah, those are bigger than normal. Okay, so
not really 25% of the small blind.
Yeah, yeah, 15. It's more than 25. It was 15,
yeah.
15, yeah, right. Okay, whatever. It's
normal. Doesn't matter.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. So
there's
guys,
220K in there,
right? And so you're the guy from the blinds checks to you.
Big blind checks.
And then
I decided to check here. I don't know. I am c-betting here a decent amount, but sometimes I'm checking.
But, okay, so here's my – with that board, was it 4-5-5 or 4-4-5?
4-5-5.
Okay, 4-5-5.
2 diamonds.
2 diamonds.
1 heart, right?
So yeah. Are we going to – we want to delay c-bet or just not c-bet here because we plan on – C betting on the turn.
Any paint on the turn,
you're betting. Yeah. But
if the blind checks again on the turn, I'm probably betting like almost any card, to be honest.
Right.
I was planning on betting almost any card on the turn, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
When I check the flop like that and it checks around, I'm betting almost any card on the turn.
Yeah.
Right. And we don't want to take a stab now. because are we afraid we're going to get check raised by the blind too much?
I know the guy in late position is known to play pretty aggressive, and he has no issue. He'd make a play there, even based on stacks.
And
there's a chance you're getting check raised too when you can represent so many turn cards, and you're also pot controlling. You only have 25 big blinds to start, so you don't want to just see bet and just give up either. Like, I just think too often someone's going to make a play at you here.
And I'll be honest, they play those stacks. The shorter stacks so terrible, you don't want to give away a ton if you don't have to. So, I mean, mm-hmm. There's so much value getting to that stage of a tournament where everybody has 20 big blinds and nobody has any idea how to play them.
Yeah.
So if the guy in late position bets the flop after you check it, we shut down? Just give up?
Depends on the sizing.
And what the small blind does.
Sean.
Yeah. Right.
I mean, literally a lot would depend on the sizing. I mean, if he fires two-thirds pot,
yeah.
I'm just going to go to the next hand. I know I can re-steal and get those chips back pretty easily.
Totally.
I only lost two big blinds.
If he fires, like, third or half a pot, then what do you do?
I'm probably just not going to get in a pissing contest at
that
point.
You're just
going to
give up.
Just
move on.
Yeah.
I mean, you only have 25 big blinds to start, so you don't have
depends
a lot of
depends on your read at the table, too, I guess. Like, you could get, you know, something out of him the way he bets or whatever. I don't know.
Right. I mean, there's just so many dynamics. It's kind of hard to know.
Mm-hmm.
I guess what worries me off the bat, though, is giving the small blind a free card when 4-5-5 is probably more likely to be a decent flop that he might connect with, especially with a fourth card to look at.
That means he's probably going to call your C-bet anyway, and you're going to blow up.
But that's what I was just going to say. So if it is something that he's willing to pursue, he's just going to call it anyway. Mm. Right. Okay.
So by checking your pot control, and if it is checked to you on the turn, then you can just bet one third pot. And I mean, if it's any paint at all, they're probably just going to shut down if they never caught any piece.
Right.
I don't know. I mean, you can make an argument either way, and I do see bet there some. I'm just saying, I've been toying live. I mean, people kind of know what a C bet is live now, even in Podunk, Florida. And I feel like I've been able to get more value by, I mean, I know it's still pretty straightforward, but not, I mean, I can play pretty ABC against these people.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, I can get value in spots where I need to, and I can get away from hands and then times I need to as well.
Right.
Yeah. And if you think that guy's competent, I mean, I think one thing I certainly noticed in Vegas this summer, having played, 15 tournaments or whatever, people are just floating so much now.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's the other thing. And then it's, are you going to fire a second barrel? And then you're really, just kind of getting into your stack there in a situation.
Your stack's so awkward, the double barrel there.
Yeah.
Yeah. And if that guy's good, he can float a bunch of hands without having to worry too much about the other guy.
Yeah.
What was the stack size of the guy in position on you? Was he? Did he have
he
covered?
He had 20 bigs to start the hand.
He had 20 bigs. So does he float there that often without a hand? With 20
Maybe
bigs?
Maybe not a ton. Maybe not a ton. But he could certainly jam there a lot.
Right. With
a lot of
spades,
dead money in the
with spades. With the diamonds. With
yeah.
Well, I guess he's not going to have... Well, he
could
have
what range of hands do you put him on from 20 big blinds just calling pre-flop?
Any pair, and 9-10 suited and plus. I don't even know if he's three. I mean, the only hands I think he's probably three betting. He Peg Me is an aggressive kid too, so I think he knows I'd be willing to stack off.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think he's three betting except his premiums. To be honest with you, he's kind of one of those like I want to see the flop before I really put it in. But if he feels like he can make a play and take it down, he's willing to.
So that board definitely.
Yeah, I don't think he's going anywhere.
Yeah.
Right.
A lot of times, like, I don't know. Regardless, you make an argument either way, I think.
Yeah, okay.
So,
So what happens?
He checks. Late position checks. Okay. So we're going to the turn. The turn is the queen of hearts. So the board's 4-5-5 queen. Two hearts, two diamonds, and the big blind grabs 11 of the awesome 10K gray chips and just slings them in the pot.
Wow.
So 110 into 220?
Yeah.
Yeah, half pot, okay.
Hmm. And what does he have behind?
He had, well, I know exactly, actually. He had 408,000 behind. I knew it was around 400. I didn't know it until 408 at the time.
Do you think he ever leads there with nothing just to take to stab? Is he that? Is he?
Yes.
Yes, okay.
I think.
I would just call, yeah. And I would call his shove on the river no matter what.
Yeah.
I call. Other guy folds. The river is a four. Black four, so the board's four. 5-5, queen four, two hearts, two diamonds, and he snap, as soon as that four hits, shoves all in.
Never has it.
I think he does have it, because
really?
Cougars knows exactly how many chips he has. but I would call, for sure, 100%. Because I think Danny's read is going to be right a lot. Like, I just don't think when they do that, they have it very often.
But wait, he leads. You do think he leads the turn with air sometimes?
I think he leads the turn with any of his draws.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, right.
That's the thing, and it was kind of. I mean, it's so hard live because there's so much table flow and dynamics. But I think he knew he felt like he was on borrowed time. Like, he felt like he was completely free rolling at this point. So he was literally down to half of a big blind. You know, 15 hands before, and now he's up to 20 bigs. And I just think he knew, and he probably made the decision on the turn. He could obviously have a five here, but I felt like if he has a draw, he figured I'm betting the turn, and I'm just firing the river and seeing if I can get him to fold his hand, whatever he has. And maybe I'll get there.
I think he shoves queen jack and queen 10 as well, or queen 9, whatever. And puts you on a draw and just turns his hand into a bluff, or I don't know. He just doesn't know what he's doing, kind of thing. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. And you've played your hand exactly like a draw. So.
Yeah. I think he's gonna bluff whatever draw or whatever he has. He's just turning into a bluff. I think he's just puts you on the draw and just shoves no matter what.
What's to stop him from playing sixes through jacks like a bluff here too?
Yeah, you're right.
Yeah. Yeah, it's certainly possible.
I snap call, and I'm over it if he has a 5 or 4, to be honest.
I didn't snap. I mean, I tanked long enough to get an exact count, and then I called, and he had 5-8 offsuit.
I kind of felt like you were going to say that, too. I don't know.
Yeah.
But I'm still, I don't care. I'm calling.
Yeah. It's hard to get away from.
So, yeah. Those were my fun hands that I didn't sleep because of last night.
And it was
the ace of hand. I was actually okay with the ace of hand. Like, I mean, I literally thought that at the point time was my best way to get a call was by making. I thought I was making it look as bluffy as possible.
Right.
Yeah.
So I mean, I'm completely okay with that. Just that's another thing. Like in the moment, I still. I mean, I agree that making 45 probably would be better, but I don't think my play was bad by any means. I mean, I was trying to.
I think you get called by tens there a fair amount of the time. So.
Yeah.
I don't think it's that bad either. He just happened to make a good fold.
Yeah.
And it sounds like he kind of thought you might have been doing it light. So, I mean, obviously you Hollywooded a little
bit. He came up to me after and he goes, man, I knew I should have called you. I don't know why I didn't.
Yeah. So it can't be that bad if he was actually thinking about calling.
Yeah. So then I had like 200K left and fold to me, well, the small blind limped, and I shoved queens and hearts, and he decided to limp with aces, and I said that was all sure.
You couldn't beat aces with queen, ten, and hearts?
No, but I will say that was the first time, and I can actually say this, because I don't remember it ever happened to me, that was the first time I was all in for my tournament life, the entire tournament.
Nice.
Was the queen, ten, that last hand.
That never happens to me. I get all in a lot. And usually lose in the first three levels. and then I re-enter. I lose again. Good times. Well, cool. Nice run, sir.
Better luck in the next heat.
Yeah.
One of these days.
Get that trophy, man.
Yeah, I know. I'm going to take a picture with it. Naked.
Cool. And Danny, I know, I think you have a couple of hands you wanted to run by us, too.
Yeah, these are online hands. Hold on, I'm just going to take off my headset and leave the room and swallow before I start. TP inside joke. I actually played a hand against LOL Plaid yesterday on Feldstars, and I got in the chat after I owned him and showed him, and we were just joking about how he made the comment in one of my videos that I apparently swallow too much.
Oh, yeah, actually, that's funny. He's actually in the hand with you?
Yeah, yeah.
That's great.
That is funny.
Yeah.
You do swallow too much, though.
All right, anyways.
All right, let's try not to get an X-rated podcast here.
All right. This is in the PokerStars, Big 162. It is during the week, not on Sunday. I think this is a final two tables?
Yep, I was watching.
Yeah, okay.
Then you told me to shut up and we talk about it later.
Yeah. Blinds are 1,400, 2,800. Ante's 350. I have 91K in chips, and I am in the big blind with ace-queen. Yeah, that's right. Okay. Alex Vick seemed to be pretty aggressive. He had 144K to start the hand, so he had 50 big blinds. And he is in the cutoff, it looks like. He opens, and so I have, like, 32 big blinds. The stacks are really shallow in this tournament, so, like, me having 90K...
is a lot.
It is a lot, and I think I'm fourth or fifth in chips at this point.
You were, yeah, one of the two.
Wow, so, is it really that shallow?
Yeah, it is. It is. So it's... my logic here, when he opens the cutoff, 30 big blinds, I want, I think my edge is to be picking on the stacks that I can steal on and force them to ship it in at this point. And you can pretty much tighten up big time and just, you know, make the final table, whatever. Obviously, I'm going to go for the win in good spots, but there's not a whole lot of room to play here. So I kind of... I used to play like this and try to go the lower variance route. I think it's fine to 3-bet and call a shove here, and you're going to get weaker aces, whatever, because it is cut off, big blind. He knows I'm a reg, probably. But I decided to ship it in. What do you guys think about that?
Okay, yeah, actually, that's cool, Danny, because this is, you know, I was talking to you before we started the podcast, and I wanted to do a little bit of math on 3-betting and the value of that versus just calling and reducing your variance. And especially when a lot of times that you can shove 3-bet, you can probably call with great odds. So,
mm-hmm. Well, this hand's probably perfect for that. So,
okay. So basically if you said it's like seven players at the table, 1400, 2800 of the blinds, right?
Mm-hmm.
And he opened to what, 52, something like
5,600.
5,600. So it was like approximately like 9,500 in the pot when it gets to you in the blind, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you have like 91.4K?
Yeah.
Okay. So I guess the first thing to talk about here is what do you think his opening range is? Because well, that's the first thing. Like, I want to do a little bit of math on this and kind of quantify things. So what do you think his opening range is?
Any ace, any pair, down to 4 or 5 suited. I'm sure he opens 5-6 off. It could be any two, but probably not.
What were the stacks, the rest of the stacks that were yet?
There's only one stack he really needs to worry about, and that is the button.
Right.
With 36K, so...
All right.
I mean, he can raise fold to him, but more than likely at this point of the tournament, if he's opening there, he very well could be calling that stack.
Right. Because, like, I have Poker Stove open, and I'm putting in all the aces, all the king suiteds, all the king offs, you know, king five and above.
Yep.
All the suited connectors, all the suited one gappers, all the unsuited, you know, connectors down to 8-7 or 7-6.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm easily getting to like 45% opening range, like without much work there. Do you guys agree that that's possible? I mean, it seems.
I think it's definitely possible. Yeah.
Right. Okay.
Anything's possible. You believe in magic.
Okay. Very nice. Okay. And so, what do you think? What do you think he's calling with there? If you jam on him.
if I shove, I think he's calling tens plus, probably ace queen off and hoping I don't have ace king.
Right, and you got blockers to the ace,
right?
Aces and the queens and the ace queen.
Mm-hmm.
So like a range of ace queen plus and aces plus is 4.7 hands, but like let's just knock some out because of the blockers and say it's like 4% of hands.
Okay.
So like we're going from 45% opening range to 4% calling range. So he's basically folding 91% of the time you jam there.
Mm-hmm.
And he's only calling about 9% of the times you jam there.
Yep.
Okay. All right. So the question here is, given that, but the fact that when he does call, you're in deep trouble, and you're
deep trouble.
Deep trouble. Almost like
is that what you tell your kids?
You're in deep trouble. All right. Heat wave. So we
hot sauce.
Hot sauce. So your ace queen is 34% against his calling range.
Yeah.
So the question here is how much is it worth adding to your stack given the chance that you could go bust though, even though it's a very small probability because you're only getting called 9% of the time and you're losing 2/3 of that time. So you're only busting out of the tournament like 6% of the time.
Right.
So I don't know. I don't know if that number means anything to you, but like how do you weigh that? I guess you brought the hand here, but I want to ask you, how do you weigh that brings on?
Just with the other short stacks, like there's seven-handed, so I'm assuming there's seven or maybe eight at the other table. So there's at this point, if I'm fourth in chips, fourth or fifth, whatever it was, with 30 big blinds, 32 big blinds, I think we're going to be at the final table within like 10 or 15, like one or two levels max. Like, and I just think if I shove this spot and get him to fold any pair that he or, you know, king jack suited or jack 10, who knows what he's going to 4-bet shove me. It's a great spot. He's still alive in the tournament if he does 4-bet chip on me here. So if I do 3-bet induce, is it worth the risk? Because I'm obviously going to call his shove.
Yeah, 3-bet inducing is super risky, right?
That's how I feel. Like at this stage of the tournament, with the other stacks, it just seems like I wanted to take the variance out. I totally get a 3-bet call. It's just a higher variance play, very high variance, especially to an aggressive guy who's capable of 4-betting me with, I mean, who knows, down to whatever, you know.
5-6 suited, stuff like
that. You just don't know. I mean, he could put me to the test there, yeah, and with hands like that.
Well, I don't even really have, like, a little math model here for that 3-bet inducing. It's interesting. I might actually add that to the spreadsheet. Because my guess is that your EV goes way up when you in 3-bet inducing, because he folds a bunch, and then when he jams on you, his range is much wider, so you know the percentage of time then you win is going to be your EV is probably a lot higher, but your risk of busto is way more than 6%, probably, you know.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, because if you're 60% against his range, you know, you're still gonna bust 40% of the time he calls.
So basically, the less risky your play is to just shove. And if you
100% less, obviously less risky.
Right.
If you want to take the risky play to really give a huge stack and win a 60-40, you 3-bet induce.
Right, because the numbers come
what
out.
It comes down to I guess you can't really quantify though how many more times with double your stack. If you double up here, you're going to finish top three as opposed to if you just steal the blinds and have just over 100K.
Right.
But I guess that's difficult to quantify, though.
Yeah. Well, let me give you some raw numbers here. So then, just round
as opposed to cook numbers.
Boy, you are the worst comedian in the world today.
It's all about the heat wave, buddy. You play with those guys, people for 3 days straight.
Getting those ice cream sandwiches in here to cool you off.
Those live jokes.
Too much hot sauce over the weekend. A little hot
Anna Kournikova, guys.
Oh, jeez.
All right.
Happens every time, but the last time.
Okay.
Oh, God.
All right. So, Yeah, I can't take it. So at EV, just throw some estimates out here. EV of a shove is like 98K, just rounded here. The net there is that you've increased your stack like 6K, but you're busting about 6% of the time. So that's the question I always have. I don't know how to weigh that. How much is?
Wait, no, I'm increasing my stack more than 6K.
On average, though.
No, on average.
Of a jam, you're increasing your stack. You're gotcha. Increasing your stack most of the time, 94. But sometimes he calls you lose. Because right. When he calls, when you shove and he folds, you have about 101K.
Mm-hmm.
When he shoved and you win, you have about 190K. And when you shove and you lose, you obviously have zero. So that'll all kind of.
Oh, gotcha. Okay.
So
I know this whole math thing's new for your newfies, but
yeah,
we've been
whatever.
Doing it here in the States for quite a few years. So
I just clicked buttons and just
trust the New Yorker.
Can you put these numbers in the metric system?
Oh, I like that one.
Shut up.
Now, what about just calling? Like, just throw all options out here. Like, you're instead of shoving. Calling your risk of ruin or your risk of busto is
zero.
Well, I mean, post flop you're going to have some, right? You know, you're going to flop ace queen, and he's going to have queen sometime, or you're going to flop eight, you know, queen 5-4, and he's going to have two fives or something, right? So you can go busto, and I don't know how to quantify that either. But Danny, what are your thoughts on calling sometimes here?
It just seems like one of those spots that. Ace queen is it's awkward to just call from that. I mean,
yeah.
If the ace flops, you're not gonna get. I mean,
well, let me ask you this: what hands are you flopping there?
I'm flatting twos through. I guess ace queen is the same hand as eights here.
Essentially.
Kinda, but...
So, I guess I'm flatting... deuces through sevens?
Yeah.
And... I mean, I might flat, like, 7-8 suited here and just hope to bank a massive flop. It's almost the same as a set hunt, obviously. But we're not quite deep enough. And with this structure, I'm probably not. So I guess maybe 9-10 suited.
Right.
Yeah. I don't really like a flat here, to be honest.
Okay.
So you're never
either, for me, it's either just rip it in and take it for what it is. If you get called, I mean.
Are you ever 3-bet folding here?
Never.
Not ace-queen. Any hands are you 3-bet folding?
Oh, yeah. Definitely.
What hands are you 3-bet folding?
It could be any two.
Yeah, right. I mean, that's game flow. Like, that's hard to... I mean, it could be...
I think this is a great spot for it to be any two, because I don't think he's ever going to flat you.
Right. Yeah. He's going to shove or he's going to fold.
Yeah. 30 deep is, like, the perfect...
Yeah, it's
just... I mean, I guess a lot depends. Say this is a 1K, are you 3-bet calling just because... You're willing to take a gamble in a tougher field as opposed to the 162? But because you had a pretty good read and thought you could chip up with less risk, you feel like you want to take a lower variance play in this situation?
If the stacks are the same, I don't think it makes a difference because...
So the field size makes no difference at all? Or not field size, field quality.
But that makes it... The chance of them ripping it in even lighter and the risk of busting even bigger.
But don't you want to take risk?
I mean, then you're just hoping that.
Against better players as opposed to if you think you can outplay the players because they're worse? Am I making sense?
You're making sense.
Yeah,
higher.
You are.
You're making sense. Yeah, I mean, against a field of awful players, he's going to want to take less risks.
I mean,
and
yeah, like you say,
dirty
bigs. $20 freeze.
But then
out.
ICM comes into play if you're in the Super Tuesday, if this is what you're saying, and if you make top five, it's huge.
Well, shouldn't ICM come into play no matter what? It shouldn't matter whether it's a Super Tuesday or whether it's the 50, what was it, the 50-50.
Yeah, I guess you're right, but obviously, I guess the money would matter more to me at that point. But I would still take the... No, I would do the exact same thing.
Yeah.
Okay.
Same argument, I believe.
Ace-King, you would 3-bet induce?
Yeah.
Yeah, because you just way ahead of Ace-Queen. Him having Ace-Queen in his range and you being ahead of that is huge here.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah.
What do you do with tens?
Yeah, I'm probably...
I think I jam, too.
Yeah, jam? Oh, wow.
I feel like tens is the same.
I feel like eights and nines are the same. Ace, yeah. Ace, ten.
Don't try and do math. You might hurt yourself, Newfie.
Give me a second. You're putting me on the spot here. Come on.
I can almost see the wheels turning from Florida in your head.
Tens, I think I 3-bet. Oh, wow. It's almost, you're right. It's almost the same. But tens are, I guess, ahead of ace-queen, where ace-queen can weed out. And it's ahead of sevens through nines,
right,
where ace-queen can get those hands to fold that you're behind in.
Oh, that's close. All right. All right. Well, okay. Let's just chalk out the tens are close. So what are we deciding here? That you take the lower variance. See, I think in the moment I'd be like, oh shit, ace queen. I'm gonna 3-bet him light and induce a shove, and I'm gonna, you know, I could double up against ace 10, ace jack,
mm-hmm.
And then I'm not bringing. I think in the moment the variance of that all might elude me. And it's a very good point that you bust that much more that way than you do from just ripping it here.
Right.
For me, it's going to be, I think, a bigger factor is the strength of the field that's left in the tournament.
Yeah.
Okay. Which was actually pretty good, to be honest.
Yeah.
And I was watching. I had the other table up as well, and a couple of guys were pretty good. And there was three guys at my table that were okay.
See, I think if there's a lot of players that are good, I'm taking the higher variance route and 3-bet calling and just taking my gamble with my equity ahead and hoping I double up.
I totally get both sides.
Me too. I don't blame you one bit.
I think in, you know, it just depends where you're at in that tournament and where you feel your edge is. I mean, I just felt if I can, like, if the blinds are going up again, it gives me three or four steel spot, raised fold spots that I can pick really well. And, you know, obviously a couple of players are still weak. I remember there was two guys at my table that were fairly weak and I could pick on that were nitty. So it brings me to about 35 or almost 40 big blinds. And when the blinds go up, I think it only goes to 1,500, 3K, or maybe 1,600, 3.2 or something like that.
Let me ask you this, Danny. What about 40 bigs? What do you think of doing there?
Wow.
that's an even stickier spot, right? Because now jamming is
yeah, no, really, I don't think big, yeah. I think I would 5-bet shove.
So it's,
yeah, because that's probably what it's going to take. Because you're going to
56. So you have about 120K. Say he goes 5.6. You go 11.5, 12.5, something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. He goes 22, and then you rip it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sounds about right.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, why are we 5-bet shoving here?
Because I'm much more likely to be light.
And you still have fold equity with your 5-bet.
Right.
Right, okay. All right, so you're not always getting it in here against his range, and you're picking up 20K a bunch of times. Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
Makes a big difference.
Makes a big difference.
It definitely makes a big difference.
Right. And then, sorry, go ahead.
I was going to say, you know what I would do in this spot?
Call.
I would get it all in and just hit an ace.
Hey, I think I saw that game before. Oh, Danny, what'd you do?
Yeah, I got an inverse kings. He called kings myself. And ace on turn later.
Well, that sounds like his fault to me. Should have folded.
Right.
And you had 34% against his range, right? So 34% of the time you're going to win. Yeah, whatever. Screw him.
I'm still not actually convinced what is best there. I get why Sean would induce and call, but I don't know. I guess I just like the lower variance route at this point.
Yeah.
No, I'm not even saying I like it every time. I think it depends on where you feel your strength or you feel your skill level is compared to the what field's left.
Right.
So that's a determining factor for me.
Cool. Yeah. All right, well, interesting hand.
All right, it's cool. Let's move on to the next hand.
All right, this is in the Big 11. This is the exact same time I was deep, or I end up final table in the Big 162, and there was like 23 people left in the Big 11 out of like 8,000. So I was at a final table, and you know, I had loads of chips. I started this hand with 40 big blinds, it was 1.38 million at 17.5 and 35,000 blinds. So we are, let's see, antes are 43.75. Cool.
That's a lot of ante right there.
I think I'm in the hijack here. 1 second. C4 is the button. Nope, I'm in the cutoff. Okay. I'm dealt jacks, jack of diamonds, jack of clubs. I open to 70K, just min raise as always. Chappie 7, some fishy kind of guy. He just, I think he's, yeah, at one point, a couple hands before, not maybe a couple of orbits before this, a guy open, I 3-bet aces. He snapped 4-bet almost all in. Guy goes all in, I'm all in. The other guy, so this same guy has aces as well, and the other guy had kings, so it was pretty sick. And me and the other guy with aces chops, so the guy that's calling me here. So kind of gives me the idea as a fish that he snap gets it in like that or whatever. So he just flats, and it's just me and him in the pot. Flop comes 7 of clubs, 5 of spades, 6 of hearts, so rainbow. I actually decided to check because we are still kind of deep, and I want a pot control. There's a lot of turn cards that kill me, and my plan is to just call if he does bet.
Isn't this kind of like my hand from earlier, even though you have pair and I had king
queen?
Yeah,
kind of.
Yeah, but he's also not under the gun.
Yeah.
True. Yeah.
I'm in the cutoff. He's on the button. So, like, I think he could be flatting any pair. I mean, he could have hands like king queen, king jack off. I mean, with a fishy guy like this, he could have anything.
So, Danny, like, what hands do you just take out of his range right now from just flatting? Like, he's going to 3-bet you.
He's going to 3-bet his premiums, and that's pretty much it, I think.
Right.
I don't think he's capable of 3-betting much more.
Right.
So I also want to get value out of his smaller pairs and any pair, for that matter, on future streets, maybe pot controlling. Because, like, if he does have... say any pair here, I expect him to bet. If he has a small pair, I think he's going to check, but I'll get value on the later street, say if paint doesn't hit the turn. I just don't want for him to just cram on me or something crazy with the set just right off the get-go. Like, I think that's definitely possible.
Yeah.
So the turn's a 7 of diamonds, so we got 7-5-6-7, so now we've got it's still rainbow and board pairs. So I bet 1/3 pot, 80K. So we've got 80K into 70, and the blinds.
Actually, hold on for a minute, Danny. So he checked behind you on the flop.
Yeah,
so,
he checked behind. Yeah.
So do 8s, 9s, or 10s check behind, or do they bet there? Do they pot control as well?
I think 8s are betting.
8s are betting, right?
I think 8s are betting, yeah.
Right.
9s are betting.
Any set should be betting.
Yeah,
I think.
Any set, 8s and probably 9s and...
Probably 10s.
Probably 10s, right?
Yep.
Yeah, okay, so we can take those out of his range, probably.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think a small, like twos or threes might check back.
So now when he checks, right, so when he checks, though, a lot of hands that, those pairs that you dominate, you can kind of pull out of his range, but you could also pull the sets out of his range.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
Sorry, just trying to narrow it down for later streets.
Yep, it's okay. Fine. So I bet 80K, so it's like one-third pot. He just calls. So I'm just like, this is weird. I think he could have, like, maybe ace-5, ace-6.
Yep. Yep.
Even a smaller pair, like I said before, he could have a hand like ace-8 that he just was pot controlling. And, you know, I don't think he knows that he's supposed to bet his open-ender, maybe,
right,
on the flop. Win check to him. And I don't think he thinks I have anything, so he could call me with just ace-jack or ace-10
yep.
here, you know what I mean?
I agree with that. I was just going to say that, yeah.
And try to take it away on the river or whatever.
Yep.
Or ace-4 he could obviously have as well.
Right.
So I guess we'll move to the river. River's a 5 of hearts. It's the board's paired. 7s and 5s are out there. I bet 245K. I think the pot was like 350 at this point. And I'm trying to get max value out of ace high. I think he could have ace 8 here a lot. And he's just going to, you know, he's going to, I need to force him to make this call here in case we chop.
Right.
I think he could have a 6. And he just shoves 1.3 million.
Snap it off.
Okay, so we don't think he has a set, unless he played it. Really, I mean, he played it slow. We took sets out of his range because he didn't bet the flop. But I guess.
So now you're saying he has quads?
No. Oh, I guess 6 is the only. Yeah. No, I'm just going back for a second and thinking about his sets on the flop. We said that he should have checked. He should have bet them all. But do you find, if you think he's kind of fishy, that he actually does that properly? Bets his sets.
Hard to say. I mean, I think even bad
always,
players
like,
try.
Always yeah. bet when they have yeah. anything.
Right, okay, all right, fair
that's
enough.
That's how I feel anyway, like, you know.
So we're not putting him on quads, we're not putting him on
I don't think he would shove 8-9 here, in case I do have a vote.
No, he would not shove 8-9 here.
Right.
There's No, he's going to show down that.
I think he can shove an under pair and put me on ace high. I think he can shove ace-6 here and put me on ace high.
He can have 7-6.
Wouldn't he just call with something like ace-6, though? Because he's got showdown value, and he's only ever going to get called by worse. I mean, by better, sorry.
He could make me hero ace-high, though, since it went just check-check on the flop and then check-call.
Right.
So he could be putting me to the test with ace-high if he thinks I'm putting him to the test with ace-high.
True.
I don't know if a fish is capable of thinking on that level, but it seemed like the way he was playing it, that he could think that way. Like, I think he puts me on ace high here all day.
Yeah.
He should be anyway, as played, because I checked the flop, and
right.
that should just say, like, you know, and then I just decided to bet the turn because I didn't think he had anything.
Right.
That's what I should say to him anyway.
Yeah. So if we fold, we're going to have, like, about a million left, I guess?
If we fold, we got two...
Like
yeah.
980. You have, like, 980 left.
About nine, yeah. So we will have, yeah, almost, well, not, no, 25 big blinds, I guess.
Right. I think...
So we're discounting quads. We're saying we don't think he has quads. We don't think he has... a straight.
Mm-hmm.
I think he has 7-6.
What about ace-5 or ace-7?
Those could definitely.
Don't
be
you think he would bet?
Yeah.
Do you think he would shove ace-5 for value here in the chance that he's beat with a set of or
I mean,
sevens?
I don't think you have a 7 that often.
Yeah. How often do you have a 7?
Because I could plan on check raising 8-7 or 2 pair on the flop.
Meh.
You don't think I would ever take that line?
Yeah, but why would he jam ace a boat here? You fold so often.
If he just said we think we can get him to hero off with ace high.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, right.
Why would he not jam 5?
That's true.
I mean, it makes sense.
Yeah.
And if somehow you have a 7, then so be it.
You think he flats a 7 preflop?
Possibly. He's fishy.
Ace-7,
yeah. Ace-7 suited, maybe.
Ace-5 suited.
Yeah.
I feel like... I don't know if Fish tried to get people to fold hands.
I mean, as far as I know, he could be flatting 5-8 off. That's what people do against me.
7-8?
Wave!
You don't think he would bet 7-8 on the flop?
See, that's the thing is, I think he's betting 7-8 on the flop.
I think he certainly should,
yeah,
but
I think it's crazy.
If we think he's bad, then
yeah, he should definitely.
Although I guess fishy and bad don't mean the same thing. So, but I don't know. I mean, I think I might. This kind of goes back to Sean's thing about your edge in the tournament. I'm assuming that since this is an $11 tournament, your edge is pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
I might find the fold button just because I think you're going to dominate. I mean, you could lose the next hand on a cooler or whatever, but I just think your edge is so big that.
What if we make the call and he has ace high or happen to turn his hand into a bluff?
We probably
win the tournament in 12K.
But I guess the problem with him turning his hand into a bluff is that he didn't do it until the river.
Like there's not many...
Well, fish randomly just blow up like this if they don't believe you, too.
That's true.
Yeah. I just feel like you would...
But think about it. If a fish has made it through an 8,000-player field, do you think he's just going to randomly throw out this bluff?
Yeah.
If he puts me on ace high, why not?
I don't know. I think you're giving an $11 player way too much credit here.
That's what I was saying.
He could be
earlier.
Frustrated, too, that he had a pair of fours and got counterfeited.
But he's still got a million chips, though. I don't think he's just going to give up.
Yeah. I would... If you have time...
Man, I really don't.
If I had time, I might OPR him and see how much the money means to him, because I just don't know if he's going to... I think I might agree with these guys, but I don't think he's going to blow up.
Oh, by the way, yeah, I probably should have mentioned this. I snap-fired the river two-thirds pot, like almost three-quarters pot.
Yeah.
I don't know if that makes a huge difference or not.
I guess what might be most interesting is to try to figure out... Well, I guess we kind of have... I was going to say try to figure out what he thinks we have, which I guess we've kind of decided that he could put us on ace high a bunch.
Mm-hmm.
I might put you on ace
high. He puts you on ace high and he thinks you're going to call him with ace high to snap to catch his bluff.
Right.
Man, it seems like
he
shoved
so many chips that he could think I could fold ace high here. If he did get counterfeited or he does have a six, maybe.
Right.
I just don't ever think he's shoving. I mean, unless he's turning a six into a bluff here.
I think he can definitely shove his counterfeited pairs into a bluff here. And he's shoving so many chips. If he thinks I have ace high, why can't he do that?
I think you're playing $11 players the same that you play 162 players, and I don't think you can do that.
Well, I don't think that at all.
And Danny, what about, I think this came up on the other hand, you know, if you fold here with 25 big blinds, your edge is probably gigantic in this tournament, and you're still perfectly fine shape.
Yeah.
You know, and you're you could be taking a very big risk here. I know, I mean, you win this, you're going to be in phenomenal shape, obviously, to win the tournament.
I just don't understand the line at all. When lines usually don't make sense to me, I don't care how deep it is. It's a completely different scenario than me shoving a hand that I could unknowingly get 4-bet shoved on by... In the last hand with, you know, and then take a 60-40 or a flip when it's a completely different scenario. When the line doesn't make sense to me, I'm not afraid to call off and go for the win.
Right.
Right.
And catch a bluff, so.
Yeah.
At first, I thought his raise was really, absurdly big, but I guess it's not that bad. I mean, it's basically 4x your bet, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, at first, I was like, God, it's just so huge that I feel like he has a hand all the time, but I mean, he could be bluffing because he does have fold equity.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
All right, well, he had A7.
He had A7, huh?
Later.
Yeah, pretty much.
So he just checked behind on the flop with A7.
And he just called the turn with three sevens.
Yeah, I mean, he's not getting his value at all.
No.
Or protecting his hand at all with that, that line. So I could see why you were confused and didn't make sense to you.
Yeah, it just made no sense. And that's pretty much the only hand that he can have, I think.
Yeah.
That's the only hand. I think more of the time than not, I catch a bluff than he has A7.
Yeah, I think you're probably right. Because yeah, I don't think
A7 on the button, too. It's weird. Like, I don't know.
Yeah.
I still don't think he does that with a 5 either. So I think it is like a 7,
right.
a 7 or a bluff.
8-7 or nothing, because I think he bets 8-7, no, on the flop?
I would think so.
Yeah.
Although he doesn't bet ace-7, so maybe he doesn't bet 8-7.
8-7 is more, probably feels more secure than a
virtual. Yeah, because he's got the back, he's got the draw.
Yeah.
Especially on a rainbow board.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. I just feel, as played that line and how he flats pre, there's no hand I could put him on. And from earlier, I just think he could have thought I had ace high and he was willing to blow up like that to try to force me off. That's a lot of chips. You know, that jam is a lot of chips.
Yeah.
I think my call is fine.
Yeah, I see the rationale behind the call.
Mm.
I do. The line does not make sense.
No.
At all.
And he just calls the set on a turn with... Yeah. You know, like, there's still a chance of, you know, what if a 9 or a 4 comes? What is he doing then?
Right.
Why isn't he raising that turn? It just didn't make sense. Anyway, I thought it was a real interesting hand.
If he had raised the turn, what would you have done then?
I probably would have just called and then check called.
Yeah. Yeah.
I would check, reevaluate. The river.
Right.
Well, the river, I think I can fold then.
Yeah, yeah. Because now he has played it like he's got a 7 or a 5 or something. Yeah. Yeah, it's a good hand. It's an interesting one for sure. Cool. All right, well, we have babbled on long enough, I guess. We should probably wrap things up. So, as always, Danny, Sean, thank you guys very much for joining us.
Good
we
times.
Appreciate it.
Definitely.
Good times.
Thanks for having us.
Yep, and... We'll just take a quick break, and then we'll come back and wrap things up here on the TPE podcast.
Thanks, guys.
Later.
See ya.
Welcome back to the Tournament Poker Edge Podcast. I want to thank Danny and Sean for stopping in, talking some hands with us.
Heat wave.
Doing a little math and some serious analysis. That was fun. Hopefully the listeners got a lot out of it. I know I did.
Yeah, you know, I think that we stopped a lot to, like, just kind of think. So I hope that's not too boring for people. Maybe it gives you a chance to think, too. But that's, like, that's really good hand analysis. I mean, that's a really good way to – That's the really right way to analyze the hands, where, you know, we kind of talk through each range and You know, we talked about, you know, what they would have done on the flop and what they did do, what disqualified certain lines. And that's kind of what I was getting at with the Gallagher Jace video and just, you know, better hand reading.
Right.
So I think it's, you know, like we spent a lot of time on each hand, and you could easily spend a ton of time on each hand if you're really analyzing.
Yeah. Yeah, you could spend so much more. I mean, yeah. not to berate the point about talking about hands in Vegas, but we did a lot of that, and there was one hand that we actually covered on a TP Live podcast. I think you actually sat in on that, maybe. The hand Danny had 10-5, I don't know if you'll even remember, but I remember we talked about it for like 30 minutes on that TP Live podcast. But what people don't realize is we talked for that hand for about 3 hours, like before and after that podcast.
Right.
Like,
yeah.
You know, and that's really, like you said, that's how pros break down hands. Like, they spend a lot of time going through every possible angle, and it's, you know, it doesn't always make for like the most dramatic, exciting podcast material. But if you want to break down hands, that's how it's done.
Yeah,
so.
And, I think it was useful though to talk about the math of that one hand. Kind of get a sense for why shoving is such a lower variance play than 3-bet inducing.
Right.
And then, you know, what you gain by doing it. And, you know, another thing was, you know, why, like, I guess we didn't talk about this, but if he's folding 90% of the time there, like, Danny could probably shove a gigantic range there. Like, we didn't really go through that. But
right, yeah, maybe we should be shoving a lot more than just ace-queen.
Right, I mean, 30 bigs is a lot, but... You know, if he's folding 90%, I mean, I still have the spreadsheet open. If he's folding 90%, let's say we're only getting 25% equity, which is like very rare, right? You're getting 30%, or more, 33% or more, 35% or more. I mean, even if we shove a hand with 25% equity and get called, it's still plus EV by, you know, 4,700 chips, which is only like one or two big blinds. And your busto only goes up from like 6% to 6.7%, right?
Yeah.
So like, if that's okay, then why isn't this okay? Why? I mean, you know, if it's okay to shove a good hand there, why isn't it okay to shove a bad hand when your equity isn't much different and your busto? But I think what it is though is that it's hard to explain because Danny shoved because he wanted to reduce his risk of busting. Right?
Right.
And you still have pretty much the same risk of busting, but your EV goes down from 6,200 chips to 47. So is that – with a bad hand goes down to that. So is that the line where it's not worth it anymore, you know?
I don't know. Right. Yeah, I'm not sure.
So many gray areas in poker.
Yeah, it goes to show that you got to spend some time with the numbers, you know, like take that spreadsheet that you were working off of, which we'll put a link in the comments section.
Yeah.
Of the podcast, so people can find that. But spend some time running those numbers.
Yeah.
People in chat all the time will say like, "Oh, you know, should I be shoving here or should I be calling here?" And I'm like, "Have you checked out Nash yet?"
Yeah,
like,
right.
I never used to use that stuff, but I finally, you know, after that, you know, bets videos, I've started playing with it. I'm far from a master of that Nash calculator, but
yeah, what's good with
but
it,
I've been using it a lot more.
What's good about it is that you know you. You become if you do it enough, it becomes a bit of a second nature sort of thing,
right?
And you don't have to do it anymore.
Yeah, yeah, that's kind of what I'm hoping is that it just after a while you only have to do it in like maybe extreme situations or whatever where you learn, oh, this is definitely a shove,
right?
Or whatever.
Right.
So, well, yeah, get your calculators out, folks. Practice. So, yeah. So, like I said, just thanks to those guys for stopping in. Always a joy to have those two on.
Yep.
So, let's talk a little bit about what's going on at TPE. What's coming up?
Well, with the World Series over, all the guys are back home making videos again. So, a lot of the pros that you guys missed, you know, and demanding that they come back and do more videos are doing videos again. So we're going to start here with, right now we have we just finished a Danny video that I just referenced earlier. His high roller win on Merge.
Yeah.
And we are running a T-Twist Micro Millions video, getting great reviews. He's helpful and entertaining.
Oh, the always entertaining.
The always entertaining. The man with the gift of gab. That's just how
that's right. Front
of him. He's got the gift of gab. And then we're going to be rolling into Mike. Well, actually, just started. Mike Leah is back. by popular demand. His last video was a couple of months ago, and he's the one that I get the most questions on. When is he returning?
Yeah, really excited about that one for sure.
I mean, he's the one who's been away the longest, but now that he's back, and you know, he's the one who is the most live pro-ish of our players. Mm-hmm. So he's traveling a lot. That's why it's hard for him to always make videos. But he's back, and he does a series on the hot turbos and the bigs. And so that's running right now. Then Ben Warrington is back with a European site sweat, which is cool for all our Euros. And then the Gal Jace video, which I will go on a limb and say is our best series ever.
Wow.
Yeah. I will also say that people will love it or hate it. So
right.
I know they will. They will. And I think you're going to have people, and I think it has a lot to do, and don't take this wrong if you hate it. but I think it has a lot to do with where you are in your learning curve.
Sure.
I think that this is not something that a beginner. So if you, you know, if you're new to the site, new to tournaments, you know, like, hey, I just, you know, made my first deep run ever and I want to get better at this because I love the feeling. There's a lot of videos for that on the site that you'll get a lot from. I think this one is definitely expert level. And you don't have to be an expert, but you have to be an intermediate player at least. And and you have to be able to pay attention, which I have problems with at times, which is why I'm doing it in like 10, 15-minute chunks.
Right.
And you have to you have to – I mean, it could get boring because he's talking about – okay, let's talk about if 7-8 here. Let's talk about 8-9 here. Like, you know, he's going through every possible hand.
Right. It's not the video you want to watch while you're playing 7-table.
No, definitely not. Definitely not. Yeah, exactly. So I'm going to go – it's my – you know, I'm, it's like – you know, like a dad, I love all my babies equally. love all my TPE pros equally. I do. Every series has great, you know, highs and lows of everything. And there's always, you know, we don't bring them on unless they're good. But I do think that this is my favorite. This series is the one that I am is changing my game the most. And therefore, I'll call it my favorite series. And sorry, everyone else.
Man, I can't wait for Casey to get a hold of you.
Yeah. No, but I mean, Casey's series, you know, add a different dimension, right? They're just different. This is what I needed at the right time, basically.
Yeah.
Actually,
yeah.
No, I wish he made the series before I went out to...
He cost you $10,000. Yeah. That's funny. Yeah, I'm looking forward to checking it out. You've mentioned it to me, and I think you might have actually thrown it up on the server where I could find it, but I haven't watched it yet. So I think I'm just going to now wait and enjoy it with everybody else. It'll be like watching, like... Breaking Bad or Walking Dead with everybody else watching it at the same time.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Oh, well, actually, speaking of Breaking Bad, so I'm exhausted and I'm going to go to bed right when we're done because I played yesterday. I played I was just hanging out with my wife. We were watching some TV. Breaking Bad starts at 10, and we had a long day, so I didn't feel like. And then we watched a little TV, and I didn't feel like sitting watching any more TV. So I went upstairs, do some TPE stuff, and then I just threw open a couple tournaments, and you know started. You know, like it's kind of like my way to wind down,
right?
Too, just like I'll join some lock turbos, like you know, near the end of the registration period where it's already like 150-300, you know.
Yeah, yeah. Where you're getting there with like 15 bigs or something.
Yeah, whatever. I mean, for $3 or whatever. I'm not practicing perfect BR management, and you could actually make a case that it's fine for BR management, but we won't get into the math of that. But so I started a five. I also late regged at 11 o'clock for a 5 rebuy. I started at 10, but it wasn't a turbo, and I didn't realize. And so my plan was to play a couple turbos and go, you know, go to bed and watch Breaking Bad after that. You know, just poker in, do some work, and then go to says. But you know, I ended up running up a big stack and playing that, and I won it. I shipped it. Right? It was like it was like 2:30. But I have to watch Breaking Bad when I cut.
So then you were stuck up until 3:30.
So I was up until 3:30 last night because I have to watch Breaking Bad. Like, why can't I watch Breaking Bad tonight, right?
Yeah, right.
No, I have to watch Breaking Bad. Do you watch it?
I actually I don't watch it religiously, but my son and my wife are addicted to it, and they watch it religiously together every week.
Right.
And yeah, so I sort of watch it, but not to the same – like. You know, not like I watch Game of Thrones, that show for me where I just cannot miss it.
Well, this is the first time I'm watching it during its run. Like I watched the first, what is that? Are we in fourth? I don't remember if we're in the third or fourth. I watched all the previous seasons like 2 months ago over like a 3 month period. Right. So,
yeah.
So I watched all those and this is the first time I'm watching it as it gets released new to.
That's cool.
So I had
And not to get too much into television, but I will just say that my son is watching Lost for the first time.
Uh-huh.
And he's on like season two, and I've been watching most of them with him, and it's pretty cool to watch Lost with somebody who's never watched it before.
Yeah, I can imagine that.
Like just watching them, you know, as things unfold, like watching them look at you, go, "Whoa, yeah, what's going on?" it's pretty neat from that standpoint. I mean, I tried to get him to watch that with me forever, but he was, I guess, just a little too young to care.
Right.
And now that he's old enough, he's kind of like, "This is the greatest show ever," and he's been watching them nonstop. Exactly. Like I think he's like in a week, he's halfway through season three.
Oh, okay. Yeah, because I think it kind of sucked from the middle of season two to the middle of season three, right?
Yeah, but I think some of that stuff is stuff that he's finding enjoyable because he has a 15-year-old kid at the end of the day. You know what I mean? Like, so there's, like, some stuff that I was not super into. Like, I don't know, some of, like, the black smoke monster things and stuff like that are kind of like, eh.
Right. But he's fine.
Where it gets a little, like, I don't know, out of this world. But he digs it. So
cool.
It's been fun to watch.
All right. Well.
So yeah, a little sidebar there.
So I think that's I said Mike, I said Daryl, and I said Ben. Those are the next three series that are up. We have some of the other pros returning. That'll keep us good till probably the next podcast. Till you guys hear the next, till we do the next one in a couple weeks.
Yep, and I know people have been asking about the podcast. We are back. Obviously some people are new, so they don't know. But like basically for the last. For every World Series, we always kind of have a little hiatus in the strategy podcast because it's just hard to get pros to do a two-hour-long podcast where they're playing WSOP events. So we do TPE Live, but we're back, so you should get a podcast from us just about every 2 weeks. Sometimes we're a little off, but we should be right around every 2 weeks.
Yep.
So we'll be back on our normal schedule until next summer.
Yep, and for all you locally that are thinking of looking for a poker trip, we are going to be at the Borgata for that event, so
yep.
We'll post some info. Actually, there's a thread already in the forum, so look.
Yeah, there's a thread there, but we'll update a little bit, maybe on a place where we can all meet for dinner or a time where we can all meet just to say hi and put faces to names and stuff like that. But that's always a fun time.
Always fun. Great time.
Pierre and Dan and a few other guys are already saying they're going, so it should be fun.
Cool.
Right on. All right, well, that's it. Long one today, but a good one, I think. So hopefully everybody enjoyed it. And we'll see you guys back here in 2 weeks.
Cool.
From TPE Podcast.
Yep.
Later, guys.
Later, guys. Hit me, raise it, baby, stay with me. Lock in intuition, play the cards with babes to start. And after she's been hooked, I'll play the one that's on her heart. Oh, whoa, 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 whoa. I'll get her heart, show her what I got. Oh, whoa, 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 whoa. I'll get her heart, show her what I got. Gambling is fun when you're with me. I love it. Russian roulette is not the same without a gun. And baby, when it's love, if it's not rough, it isn't fun.